A very warm welcome to Professor Cedric Villani, who's with us here today. And my name is Bhavna Mehra. I head the Infosys Science Foundation. So I'm very pleased to welcome him to deliver an Infosys Science Foundation lecture on modern romance between math and society. Thank you for coming, Professor Villani. Happy to have you here.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Let me also say that first, it has been a pleasure to work with the Infosys Foundation for the past year because I was participating in this jury for the Infosys Prize, which was also an opportunity for me to better appreciate the how many mathematical talents there are in this country. And also that India has a very special place in my heart for, of course, the reason that it is here that I received the Fields Medal in 2010. The Fields Medal is attributed at the International Congress of Mathematicians, which takes place every 4 years. And one of the reasons why we are proud that it's not the same as Nobel Prize is that Fields Medal is awarded in front of the community, by the community, so it's awarded at the occasion of the main gathering event of the whole mathematical community. It's not a selected event for a happy few, it's for everybody. And those days, so in 2010, it was in India, in Hyderabad, and of course, it was a very special period of my life. I will recall this until I die, I think. So as soon as I was out of the plane and started to feel again the atmosphere of India, it brought back a lot of pleasant memories to my mind. And I am all the more happy that we could organize this conference here in this beautiful Infosys campus. So as it was recalled, it will be in the form of some story and some discussion, you know, about certain things related to mathematics and to how we see mathematics in the modern world. Let me say that since the Fields Medal, my life has changed a lot, in particular because I started to do so much work and be so much invited for outreach activities with the task of explaining to the outside world what mathematics is about and how mathematicians work. A very important role, I believe, because nowadays mathematics has taken an extremely important role in the world, and so it's even more important than before that the whole society understands about how mathematical research works. And this talk will be part of this. And speak about modern romance is very strong, but there is something very much emotional in our relation to mathematics, whether we like it or not. Even those who have some allergy for mathematics are fascinated with it. And romance also because this interaction with society is so. Let me go right to the point by mentioning this very striking study, which was performed by a company named CareerCast in the United States and published for a wide audience for the first time in January 2009 by the Wall Street Journal, in which they ranked all the jobs in the world, all those they would think of, and arrived at the conclusion that mathematician was the absolute winner. Best job in the world for this company based in the US. Look at this picture with a happy mathematician floating high above and poor lumberjack who has been ranked as the worst job in the world. Of course, we have to always think that rankings should never be taken too seriously. They you know, add many elements which are not comparable. They cannot take accurately into account all the culture, all the context ingredients. And I am sure that there are lumberjacks around the world who think that their job is the best that they could ever imagine. However, we have to think of why was this job mathematician ranked as first? This was taking into account things like salary, of course, but freedom, you know, possibility of career, also the intellectual satisfaction, and also the use and the growth perspectives. This was in 2009, but when the same company redid the study 5 years later, again, they put mathematician as their number one job, insisting on the versatility of this job. Mathematician, by definition, can work on anything, because mathematics is about the abstraction. It can be applied to about any concrete problem. And in our world, mathematics is present more than ever. It's present in the modern economic theories. It's present in modern computer science. It's present in our games. It's present in our approach to statistics, to all kinds of problems in all sciences in which mathematical assessment is crucial. If you look up all the main recent controversies in science or huge discoveries in science, even if it is a field which is not mathematics, you will most of the time find that there is some mathematical ingredient behind. For instance, discovery of gravitational waves. There was a strong mathematical component in predicting and detecting what was going to be observed. For instance, controversy about GMOs. There is a strong problem about how we should interpret the statistical studies and estimates, and so on and so forth. And mathematics is here everywhere, often hidden in all our modern world. Even in things in which you forgot how it works because we use them so easily, it will be hidden. One example is the automatic translator. You know, automatic translation has started to change our world. And soon, I mean, it will be an even bigger revolution when we will have real-time, convenient translation that will allow people, you know, to convert English into Chinese and vice versa. We are not yet there in a fluent way. But this will come someday, and with a lot of mathematics that are embedded in the process. And this mathematics will change the way that people will communicate to each other. Oh, here's another example, more on the technological and health side. This is a picture here on the left of the artificial heart, which is being developed by the team of Professor Carpentier in Paris. Has been going on for decades already. And one day, I believe, this will be used in place of heart transplant to cure the most terrible heart diseases. Lot and lot of work. What is it based on? Of course, it's a lot of medicine, biology, but also material sciences, chemistry. But also some good mathematics is needed there through the form of some good algorithm and some good modeling of the interaction between the heart and the rest of the body. And the same, the list could continue on and on. This is one of the main reasons why mathematics has achieved such importance in our modern world. But mathematics has also made its way to our cultural world and in the arts. Take, for instance, this building, which is already famous for us lovers around the world, the Louis Vuitton Foundation, which was inaugurated recently in Paris also. Look at this building. It looks so non-mathematical, so asymmetric, so hard to grasp. Actually, people have all kinds of theories of what it could represent, whether it's a hatching or some insect or whatever. But main thing is if you plan some building like this and have it constructed, there is all probability that it will collapse instantly. Except if you took good care of modeling it completely and have it reproduced in a computer program that we check in all detail that it stands on its feet by computing and simulating all the forces and so on. I'm sure that this is a problem familiar to many people who, of course, work in computer science. You have problems about assisting the development of construction, conceiving with the help of the computers. And of course, it's developing and coding. But we should never forget that behind, there are some mathematical models. A couple of decades ago, such a building could not have been built because, among other things, the software was not up to the date. And here's another example that I guess also is very familiar to some people in the audience. Movie industry. As we know, the movie industry is one of the biggest consumers of mathematics in the world. They need a lot of mathematical power to compute images and rendering. And this was the case in spectacular way when the award-winning movie, Gravity, was out. It needed years of development of the right algorithms and schemes to get the images right. Because everything in this movie basically has been computed through algorithms and computers, except for the faces of the actors, to say, or which almost I'm hardly exaggerating here. And in this way, you can see that mathematics is not just a way to understand the world, or not just a way to solve a certain practical problem. It's also a way to recreate a world. That is, of course, very much related to our world, but that can be modified in many ways. In this case, it's like if I want to build a new world in which I decide to suppress the gravity by just changing the equations. And that's the power of mathematics as some way to create something new. Nowadays, it's routine, for instance, in the film industry for animated cartoons, to have various mathematical and physics models about the way that characters move, the parts of the body, or the hair. There are a lot of various models for hair movement, which will not reproduce accurately the reality, but make it even more attractive. Oops. Okay. This idea that mathematics is able to create a new world, and at the same time to understand the existing world, is not new. It was put to a high level of power in modern days by the computers and the revolution of information technology. But it was already present since the time of the ancient Greeks, when they started to develop mathematics as we understand it now. Mathematics, of course, existed before the Greeks, but as a way to solve practical problems. When the Greeks got it and transformed it, they thought of it rather as some part of philosophy, a way to understand the world and to find universal rules. It was going well with their vision of the world and with the idea that with words and ideas, you can master the world. And all the basic ingredients of the mathematical research were already apparent in the what represented the main figures from the Greek mathematicians. Here for me are the five more emblematic. And from left to right, you will have first Thales, the first philosopher, or the first mathematician, as people call him often, emphasizes on this idea that mathematics is part of our quest for understanding the world. Next comes Pythagoras, with the idea that the world is based on mysteries that we have to uncover. Many of these mysteries being in the form of relations between numbers, almost like secret code that we should decipher. Next, in the middle comes Euclid. Euclid, we know from his famous book, The Elements, which for a long time was part of the curriculum of mathematics in many countries. And the elements emphasize this idea that mathematics is a collective work, and that by the power of writing and rewriting and perfecting our theorems, making it in book form, exchanging them, we can collectively improve it to a dramatic point. Then comes Archimedes, who personifies the genius in mathematics, the brightest mathematician of ancient times. By the way, his face is engraved on the Fields Medal. Finally, in the list that I put here is Eratosthenes. Maybe not as bright as some of the others, but very important for the idea that mathematics also comes as a way to transform the world that we live in, including our representation of this world. We shall come back to this in a moment. But first, let us also say that the ancient Greeks also introduced this notion of beauty in the mathematics, which has remained so crucial for mathematicians worldwide. When we think of a mathematical theorem, and when we talk about it between us, the word beauty, beautiful, will come up again and again. And it will also drive our understanding and drive our thinking. We will always search for the most beautiful path. Aristotle said it long time ago, the chief forms of beauty are order, commensurability, and precision. Wow, isn't he talking about mathematics? Looks like it. Precisely in the sequel of the text, he continues saying that this is why mathematics is regarded as the most beautiful subject. And more than 2,000 years later, Henri Poincaré, the famous French mathematician, would talk about that profounder beauty which comes from the harmonious order of the parts. Something comes, something else comes together, and the two meet in a beautiful way, like, you know, two characters in a novel that will have an interaction coming right to the point. This is what we like as mathematicians, when two ideas come together and become entangled and something beautiful gets out of that. That beauty is not only for professional mathematicians. It can be appreciated even by teenagers, even by kids. And this is what fascinated me as a teenager when I was working at mathematics. And my favorite subject in those days was Euclidean geometry, the same as the ancient Greeks liked to develop. Properties of triangles, circles, lines, and so on. And I found it so beautiful. Like, you know, I take a parallelogram, sum of the squares of the sides is the same as the sum of the squares of the diagonals. Where does this unexpected relation come from? It looks such a coincidence. There must be something behind it. Let me say that geometry of the triangle has no use whatsoever in the modern world. You know, if you are not a mathematician, why care? And if you are a mathematician, why care, since there is no research in this subject any longer? But still, when I was learning my way, you know, as a teenager about what is it, mathematical concept and mathematical proof, this is the subject that I think most preciously helped me in understanding to build a reasoning. The mathematician's work is to find truths, to understand the deep reasons for things. And that's what you do when you do a Euclidean geometry. Later, it became my job to make proofs, and I had to write proofs as long as more than 100 pages on difficult mathematical concepts bearing on complicated physical systems. But you have to start somewhere. And as a beginning, you have to train about making up a 10-line proof about a simple geometrical problem. And little by little, learn how to make it more complex. And there is more than that. Within Euclidean geometry, you learn about what science is about. What is beautiful about Euclidean geometry? Well, sometimes you have three lines that meet together, as if by miracle. Or sometimes you have 9 points that are on the same circle, as if by a miracle, a coincidence. And you learn that it's not a coincidence and that there is a reason for it. And you learn how to replace a beautiful coincidence by a beautiful explanation. All of science is like this. Start by some observation of the world, which looks like a coincidence, something that makes you wonder, and replace it by a beautiful explanation. And so by doing this elementary geometry, you learn a lot about what it is, the scientific reasoning and the logical reasoning. Now, it's not just about reasoning, of course. And now it's time to go back to Eratosthenes and explain why I was saying that he changed our vision of the world, the concrete world, using mathematics. So Eratosthenes was known both as a geographer and a mathematician. And one day he heard about this fact that in Sien, in Egypt, there is a certain well which on a certain day is lit exactly vertically. Like, you know, the light from the sun comes down vertically so that the bottom of the well is lit. What to do with this? And he thought we shall use this to measure the earth. In those days, the Greeks knew only a small part of the world. They had no idea about America. Most of Africa was unknown to them. Most of Asia was unknown to them. And still, Eratosthenes was able to pinpoint the dimension of the Earth with amazing accuracy, like a few percent of error, not more. What was the reasoning? Well, you know, at about the same longitude as Sien was Alexandria, which was also in Egypt. Not too close, but not too far, so that you can measure directly the distance between the two cities. And then, at the same time, when the sun is vertical in Sien, look what is the angle of the sun to the vertical in Alexandria. How do you look at this angle? By looking at the shades. You know, when the sun is high, the shades are very short. When the sun is low, the shades are very long. Simple trigonometry gives you the angle by comparing the length of the height of some stick to the length of its shadow. And then you can have access to this angle, which is denoted by theta here. And then it's a simple computation to deduce from this the length of the whole Earth. And you know, it was very close. Because there is this estimate of Eratosthenes' computation, which is very close to the actual estimate of about 40,000 kilometers. So with this, with a simple mathematics and observation and cleverness, Eratosthenes could change our vision of the Earth in a concrete way. The Earth is not infinite or so large, we can measure it. Notice also that this, in a way, is what we would call an innovation process. Innovation is about when the theory meets the real world or the real needs with some cleverness, not always with the highest, most advanced theory of the day, but some cleverness included. And this was clever. Now, this was the start, Eratosthenes, of the beautiful story of mankind little by little, mastering space and time. This was about space, you know, using mathematics to do such a thing as measuring the Earth. What about mastering time? Well, let's talk a little bit about the measure of time. For a long time, it was measurement of time was based on fluids that are running, with the exception of some ancient clocks which were made by the Greeks and whose memory was lost for 1,000 years. And then in the Middle Ages, people started to rediscover and perfect the clocks, mechanical clocks. But you cannot get very precise with such mechanisms as they had in those days. And about the 15th, 16th century, they were stuck with an accuracy of maybe 1%. And then came a very clever idea. A very clever idea was from the observation of the pendulum. You know, this is a pendulum. You look at some mass which is oscillating, and this is something like a string. Pendulum, you know, they were always around us. But the first time that scientists look at them, it seems, was with Galileo around 1600. And he noticed that the time of oscillation of the pendulum does not depend on the mass, but only on the length. And he also noticed that it depends very little on the angle, that is, on the energy. If the oscillations are small, then this period is almost the same as not exactly, but almost. Later, in the 17th century, they could explain this with differential equations and write down the differential equation of the pendulum that we still use nowadays and teach to our students. And also, it was explained how to go from there to an exact computation of the approximate time by so-called linearizing the equation, making it simpler. And from this equation, you can see that it will only depend on two parameters, the period of oscillation, g, which is the strength of gravity, and l, which is the length of the string. Okay. And then one day, people said, why not revert the logic? We know that the pendulum oscillates regularly because we compare this to measurements of time. Why not use the pendulum to define the time measurement? If you do this, however, it's not so precise because as the pendulum loses energy, the period of oscillation will change slightly. Until somebody had a very clever idea. That somebody was Huygens, who was arguably the best mathematician in just the middle of the 17th century. And he thought, what about constraining my pendulum with some curve that will limit its movements. And he discovered that there is a special curve that you can use that will constrain it in a beautiful way. That special curve is the cycloid, well known also for its geometrical properties. It's the shape which is described by a point which you single out on a wheel which is rolling. And look what happens. If you take a cycloid curve and you put your pendulum at the apex of the cycloid, so here you have the pendulum, and here this curve is constraining the motion of your pendulum. Then the motion of the pendulum will not be circular, but will be again a cycloid. And what is beautiful is that the length of oscillation will become completely independent of the energy. High energy, low energy, it will become the same period. And Huygens used this principle to make clocks, which were much more precise than the previous ones. This was the start of the high precision clocks that would be perfected and perfected again and again in the coming decades and centuries. Up to the time when in the middle of the 18th century, people were able, using extraordinarily clever technology with this and many other developments, clocks that were so precise that on a trip of several months, they would vary by just a few seconds. So precise that they could be able, they were used to solve the so-called longitude problem. When you are at sea, traveling, how do you know what is your longitude? Latitude is easy. You look at the stars, you compare the local time, the position of the stars, etc. But longitude is so difficult. It was a problem of life and death in certain parts of the world, because in some places in the ocean, there are these storms that you want to avoid, and you have to know where to be. Longitude, on the other hand, is something that we can experience very familiarly when we travel. You know, going from Paris to Mumbai, as I did last week, I could notice the difference in my body because of the jet lag. And this is mainly the longitude change. And the solution for the longitude problem was exactly this. Take a very, very precise clock, take it with you in your ship, and when you are at sea, compare the local time with the time of the clock that you took with you. And if the clock is very precise, you can determine from this the longitude. So in this occasion, mathematics and technology were used to save lives. And this was part of this whole principle that better understanding our world, the space, the time, the laws of physics around, one day can be so useful for practical applications. Let me also say that other wonderful stories arose from these simple ingredients. For instance, one day, a Frenchman named Jean Richet noticed that his pendulum was not exactly right when he took it from Paris to Cayenne, which is near the equator. And he didn't know why. It was just by a tiny amount that there was a variation in the period of the pendulum. And when this was reported to Newton and Huygens, they understood that it meant that the force of gravity was changing, and that it meant that the Earth was not exactly spherical, and that the Earth was slightly flattened. Slightly, like 0.5% was the estimate of Newton. Now we know it's more something like 0.3%. But this is something you do not even see with your eyes when you look at a picture of the Earth. But here, mathematics allows you to look at the invisible, to detect a phenomena which is so sharp that it will escape direct investigation. And by which method? By looking at just the oscillations of pendulum. It's amazing to see the connection between this small phenomenon of the pendulum and the big cause, which is the flattening at the scale of the Earth. Again, mathematics is here to go beyond the limits of our intuition. That's the single most important thing about mathematics, maybe. It has been devised in such a way that you can make reasonings and conclusions on territories for which you will not find by your ideas and intuitions and common sense what the solution could be. Now, let me not say more about this relation between space, time, mathematics, except the fact that, famously, it again played a crucial role in our revolution of the understanding of space and time in the 20th century, when Albert Einstein came up with his theory of general relativity. At the start of the theory of general relativity was the mathematical theory of curvature, which was initiated long before, in the middle of the 19th century, by Bernard Riemann, a famous German mathematician. Riemann himself thought of it not just as a mathematical problem, but also as a way to understand the space and time. But it was formulated in a mathematical way. It was developed by mathematicians such as Ricci in Italy until it met the right person, Albert Einstein, who understood by discussing with his mathematician friends that the theory of Riemann was exactly what he needed to start his theory of general relativity. So the mathematical problem was so much deeply connected with the problem about physics and the way we think of our world. And even much later, it served as a technological small revolution when it was the time to devise the GPS, which would never work if it did not take into account the relativistic corrections. Riemann never had the idea that from these would be built devices that allow you to know exactly where you are, or he did not formulate it explicitly. And conversely, people who use a GPS around the world, most of them never heard of Riemann. But that is what technology is about. The point in which the science has been incorporated in a technological device such that you can forget about the principles that built it. But it's important to remind that behind every technological advance, there are some scientists and theories behind. Riemann also gave his name, by the way, to the most famous mathematics problem of all times, the Riemann hypothesis, according to which a certain function, which is called the Riemann zeta function, would vanish only at certain places which are apart from integer values, all on a single line in the complex plane. About 10 years ago, a journalist from The Guardian, which is otherwise a great journal, fantasized that if this problem was solved, it could bring disaster for the internet. None of this is true, but the problem is indeed a dramatic one, because it has consequences about the way that prime numbers are distributed among all numbers, and consequences for many other fields of mathematics, which are connected. For instance, we know that there is a deep relation between this zeta Riemann function, which is here given, and the levels of energy of an abstract atom, so to speak, a random matrix, as mathematicians say. Why would there be a connection between number theory and quantum mechanics? Nobody knows, but we know from experiments that such is the case, from numerical experiments. Riemann lived for these kind of things of connections. He wanted to find all the right mathematical languages and concepts to have a grand unification of mathematics and physics and see everything connected and put together a coherent picture. By the way, it is very frightening to look at all the deep concepts that Riemann gave his name to, in spite of him dying before the age of 40 years. Riemann is one of these very rare, very romantic figures in the story of science, as, by the way, would be Ramanujan, guy that has a short life but manages to make a unique impact on the way we think of the relation between the human mind and the science. So, you know, when you are sincere and honest as a mathematician, even if you are a very recognized mathematician and famous, you can only be very humble in front of people who did such great achievement. It's also very inspiring, and it can be an inspiration to people very much outside the field of mathematics, the achievements of human mind. Actually, I met once a famous rock singer who told me that from time to time, she goes on the grave of Riemann to get some inspiration, to meditate. And this reminds us that great scientists can be seen as inspiration. It says genius and poetic work, not just practical work. And by the way, let me also mention that I too like to go over the graves of great scientists. And this picture of me was taken in 2006 in Vienna as I was a guest of a conference in his honor. And you know, I had worked on the equations of Boltzmann, one of the founders of gas theory, for 10 years. He had become part of my life. I thought of him as part of my family. I had to pay tribute. And in science, in particular in mathematics, we always live with the dead people. It's not something that is grim or sinister. On the contrary, we are happy. We feel they are still alive through our work, their ideas. We live with them, we understand them, we work on them, we develop their programs, and so on. And the works of Boltzmann about understanding how a gas can be predicted has been inspiring for many people, from Einstein to Smoluchowski and their theory of Brownian motion, and the proof of atomic assumption, atomic hypothesis, which was also made through theoretical physics and mathematics, but also information theory, which was started by Shannon on the same concept of entropy as Boltzmann, but also to engineers around the world who use the Boltzmann equation to simulate and work on devices such as engines and so on. Not only do we live with these great dead people and their ideas, but we're also able to make them encounter nowadays, to make their theories come together and find the relations between them. This is what happened to me, for instance, at one important part of my career, when I was part of a group of people who discovered about 15 years ago that there was a hidden and beautiful link between three well-known mathematical theories. One was the theory of economic optimization developed by Russian Leonid Kantorovich here, who wanted to develop the mathematics of optimizing the economy for a communist regime. And his theory of optimization is about how to do things with the least amount of effort, least amount of expenses. It's like what we call nowadays a problem of operational research. How to do the best given all the parameters that we have and the resources that we have. He got the Nobel Prize for this. And nowadays, his theories are used every day all around the world to optimize the prices, the organization, in shops, in companies, everywhere. Here in the middle is Riemann. I told you already about his theory, his geometry. He was interested in understanding the geometry, what it means for a space to be curved, distorted, and how to measure it, and how to understand it. And on the right, it is Boltzmann. I told you about his theory of gases and how we want to predict. For instance, if you put a tiny amount of gas, some flux, in a box, how it will invade the whole box and what you can see about it. This is about economy, this is about geometry, and that is about gas. No relation, apparently. Three beautiful theories and very useful, each on their own right. However, we discovered that there is a deep link between them, and this allowed us to solve some problems in geometry. Let me describe this link in layman's words and again emphasize on what I said moments ago about Poincaré. What we love in mathematics is the beauty of the harmony of things that come together, often in an unexpected way. So imagine you want to understand how our universe is curved. One basic notion in this is the positive curvature, like on the Earth, in which when you have two trajectories, which are each of them optimal in the sense that they are shortest distance, they will first separate and then converge. Imagine you take two planes starting from the North Pole at the same moment and going in straight lines. So they will go around the Earth. First, they separate from each other. At the level of the equator, they are very far apart. But then they will get closer again until they come together at the North Pole. Okay. This is positive curvature, diverge and converge. And now, here is a way to detect if you are in positive curvature. Take a gas, which has a certain configuration, and make sure that the gas will go in another configuration at time one, say after 1 minute. And imagine, it's a thought experiment, that the gas will do so in such a way as to minimize the effort, as if it's an economical problem and the gas wants to spend the least possible amount of energy, as in the problem of Kantorovich. And all along, the gas changes configuration. Use the formula of Boltzmann to measure the amount of disorder inside the gas. And plot the curve from time initial to time final. If that curve is concave, then it will be a mark that you are in positive curvature. So there is this link between the disorder in the gas, the curvature of your geometry, and the minimization of the energy. And this is just a link here between these three ideas. But with this, we were able to solve some problems of geometry. And it was the start of a thick book which I wrote on the subject. And it was the start of many developments with now dozens of people working in this field on this connection and using this to make new discoveries about geometry. Also how mathematics can renew itself always, adapt to new problems, and so on. And this is part of the beauty and of the adventure of it. Let me insist, however, on one thing. Mathematics is beautiful, it's useful, best job in the world, whatever. Still, let me not conceive that the life of a mathematician is based on a lot of frustration, because you are constantly battling with the problems. And your usual thought when you are a mathematician is, how can I be so stupid? How is it that I don't understand what to start, what to do, and so on? See me on this picture? That's the typical state of the mathematician. Waiting for Henri Poincaré here in the background to give me some hint about how to solve. Waiting and waiting for the idea. Yes, it's tricky. Yes, it's difficult. But at the same time, that's part of the motivation, part of why we find it exciting. If it was so easy, it would not be so interesting. And let me use this cartoon to contrast the public perception of science, like something that is logical and deterministic. You do science and experiment and so on, to the real science, in which sometimes your experiment breaks down and you have to restart everything. Sometimes your amazing results turn out to be complete crap. Sometimes you think a lot and eventually get some good understanding before you find out that somebody got it 50 years ago, and so on and so forth. It's such a big, big mess. And that is part of the fun and why it is precious. And part of my mathematical life, I one day wrote in a broad audience book which was not about explaining the mathematics, but about explaining the life of the mathematician as a kind of diary, and at the same time as a kind of adventure novel. I did not want the reader to understand what the mathematics was about, but to understand this chaotic process, how it takes so much effort to first understand what subject to work on, then to get the right ideas, how many mistakes you make in the process, how much travel you have to do, people to encounter to get the right ideas, what a chaotic and unpredictable life it is. And this had a tremendous impact on the readers. And I got all these comments, you know, I did not understand anything about the mathematics in your book, but I felt so much connection with the kind of life that you are living. And it reminds me of my area, it reminds me of this, because there are common features in the lives and jobs of all people whose job it is to find new ideas, to be creative. And some of these common features are that your life is so chaotic, unpredictable, depends so much on the outside world and on the people that you meet, and so much on a big, random, chaotic process, which is science in general. And with this, I will conclude this about this romance of mathematics in society, not only because mathematics is so useful, do I see it as a romance, but also because the mathematical research, as science research, is also a modern adventure. And that can be seen as something which is inspiring even for people who have nothing to do with the mathematics and don't want to know anything about it. Thank you.
Thank you so much for that very, very engaging and surprisingly entertaining talk on mathematics. And if anyone has any questions, I request you to please press the button on the microphones in front of you. Press the button and you'll have the camera on you so we'll know who has to talk.
I had a chance to see the Antikythera machine in Athens. And, I guess they say it's some kind of precursor to a computer or clockwork. But I was always wondering, why is it that it's just a one-off of its kind? I mean, why is it that we don't see any kind of experimental process, you know, leading up to it? With such an enigma, can you throw some more light, please?
Yes. While I am not an expert, I think that this Antikythera clock is one of the biggest mysteries about the history of technology. First, it is amazing to think that such a clock existed and that everybody forgot about it for such a long time. But second, it is very disturbing to see that we know it by only one instance. Of course, there has to have been some previous attempts, some development, some less elaborate machines, and so on. And because we don't have this, this makes us wonder. Maybe there are also many other technological things that we have not uncovered. Maybe they were much more advanced than we think. And why is it that it was not reported in the writings? Maybe we are missing some full chapters of the story. Sometimes with the Greeks, some surprises have come also in mathematics. You know, for a long time, people believed that the Greeks had no notion of combinatorics. And one day they discovered a manuscript which was full of combinatorics. And they discovered that the Greeks actually had an advanced knowledge of combinatorics. But it was just one manuscript that made us change our mind. So it shows that about the history of ideas, we are on very fragile ground in this respect. And also the Greeks, it's some kind of very particular moment in the history of sciences. The fact that after the Roman invasion and so on, all the knowledge was lost. The fact that it took maybe 14 centuries before we could improve on the astronomical knowledge of the Greeks. All this suggests that it was a very special environment. Special, like a microclimate for ideas that they had there, probably related to their special geography with a lot of cities and a lot of islands. You know, maybe it was something like the Silicon Valley of that time in the sense of ideas. We know the strength of Silicon Valley in California is that there are all these various poles that interact and compete against each other and that they change and they have a lot of innovation coming from this. On the other hand, in the case of the Greeks, it was not so much about innovation than about the theories. So it's some kind of accident in the history of ideas. I think it's nice to keep this in mind. I am fascinated also by this clock. Who is next? Yeah. Yes.
I heard Bhavna say that you thought that mathematics isn't hardwired in our brains the way language is. But, I mean, the fact that there are mathematical prodigies, especially when it comes to just numbers, not geometry or other things, doesn't it suggest that perhaps at some level it is, that it requires the least amount of acculturation to start thinking at least about numbers?
Numbers are, well, it's one of the discoveries of neurosciences that small numbers are hardwired in our brain. Small being 1, 2, 3, and 4 is at the limit between small, between big and large. But it's very striking that even the newborn have something about 1, 2, 3. Like if you present the newborn with 3 objects, it will not be the same neurons as if it is 2 objects. And even some animals have this also. It's hardwired because it has some applications. You know that 4 is like the maximum number of objects that we can see immediately at a glance. You see 4 objects, you recognize it's 4. If it is 5, you have to, you know, count, check. Ah, this is 5, okay. And it's also related to that. So small numbers are hardwired, and from that, it's natural to think that about any civilization develops numbers by continuing. Even though it has been shown also by neurosciences that our natural representation of large numbers is not in the same form. And when we compare numbers, our brain typically uses, it's more like continuous analogies. When we want to compare like a big herd of cattle to a small herd, it would be continuous analogies made by the brain. There is this comment that will come out. But apart from that, you know, for elaborate concepts, very striking to know how much the history of mathematics is simple compared to the history of music or the history of culture and so on, or the history of tales. And basically, it's as if there is just one big motion of mathematics across the world. It's not completely true, but it's almost true. And by the way, you know, after the zero was invented, it took out all the rest, but zero was invented essentially once. Then it gained all the rest. You know why we use the letter X to denote the unknown in mathematical problems? It all comes from one manuscript, which was a translation from the Arabic language to the medieval Spanish language. And there was the In Arabic, there was this letter like sh, maybe, to say something, as in shoy or something, shoya, something, I don't know. Some word in Arabic starting with sh, and to translate it into, and it meant something, you know, the unknown quantity. Translate it into Spanish, they use the letter X, one manuscript. And then everybody in the world, in the end, uses the letter X. It shows how much our knowledge derives from a small number of sources. And so I think this is good evidence for the fact that it is not naturally designed to do mathematics. Otherwise, it would have appeared in many places. Quite in contrary to music, I mean, there are thousands of different musics around the world.
Well, this thought comes from a trick question which we used to solve in childhood. We used to equate two equations and tell that's how someone's age is bigger than the other person. So just this thing comes to my mind that 0 by 0 is undefined.
0 by 0
is undefined. And infinity again has always, you know, made people think about can anything be infinite in life. But in society, we have many things which are undefined. And there are dreams which are considered sometimes infinite. How do you see it from the perspective of mathematics?
First, let me say that infinity is a monstrously complicated problem for mathematicians conceptually, but society is even more complicated. I mean, understanding mathematically the society, you just need to open your newspaper every day to understand that it's not a mathematical model that will be able to describe all this craziness that is society. Let me say that infinity is a very tricky concept, but it is a mathematical concept. There is no such thing as infinity in the real life, or not that we have seen it in reality. But infinity is a way by which we approximate some of the things in reality. And infinity can have many different concepts, many different incarnations. One of the big discoveries about by mathematicians about infinity is that there are many infinities, and that they are different. There are many different infinities, some of them bigger than others, some of them way bigger than others, and so on. One of the most famous problems of 20th mathematics century, actually, which was solved by an analyst and logician named Paul Cohen in the 60s, was about to know whether there was an infinity which was larger than the infinity of the natural integers, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, etc., and smaller than the infinity of the real line, which is infinity of the real numbers. And the problem was to know whether there was an infinity which was in between, and the solution was that it is impossible to know. For this, Cohen got the Fields Medal and the eternal admiration of the mathematicians, because it was such a surprising result and a new era in logic about finding that some things in logic are neither true nor false, but you cannot know.
Do you think if you use your mother tongue and learn mathematics, it's more effective than other language? In France, your mother tongue is French, so you may not come across this. A country like India, where our mother tongues are different and the science is taught in English language, which is not our mother tongue, do you think how effective it is?
I think it's an important issue. Professional, for researchers, professional mathematicians, it doesn't really care what language we use. When we see the words, we know it triggers the concepts, and it is known that mathematical thinking is, at a deep level, non-verbal. We see images, connections, we have mental representations which are not based on words. There is even some good support by neurosciences about this. But for a child learning the subject, which words are used is quite important. And if the word is not in the mother language, it can be quite a problem. And situation, unfortunately, is not so easy as you would just say, but let's make that everybody learns in the mother tongue. Because traditions are very different from one language to another, and there are some languages in which there is a long tradition of teaching the mathematics, and other languages in which it's not the case at all. And we can only see that sometimes the effects are bad. Sometimes it's also the teachers are not prepared to change the language, and so forth. When you think about mathematical education for the kids, you cannot do it independently of the teachers. The teachers are human beings, trained in a certain way, it's difficult for them to change their habits overnight, and so on. And it was shown in particular in part of the Arab world, in part of the former French colonies. At some point, they said, let us now do the teaching of sciences in Arab, which was natural, you know, as part of the independence, full independence process, and so on. And this did not work at all. It was a disaster, because the textbooks were not ready, the teachers were not ready, and so on. And there was not the tradition of how to use the concept, and so on. And it was a big problem. And in certain areas, they had to come back to the French teaching of some of these. So these issues about connection between science and language, they are important, and they have to be taken with a lot of care. You know, I am not saying that things should not evolve, but things should evolve with quite some care.
Is there any algorithm to measure the emotions?
A mathematical way to measure the emotions. Hey, no, we are not yet. We don't even have a good, I don't think we have a good qualitative model for emotions. You know, some people in psychoanalysis, psychology, developed a whole branch in which they were using topological analogies for how our mind works and our ideas and so on. At some point, it was popular in France. Somebody like Lacan, who was one of the great guys in psychoanalysis, made a big story about this. But I don't believe it is an accurate representation. I think we are very far from it. But, you know, so there is a novel which appeared in the UK recently, I think a couple of years ago, which I like quite a lot, which is called The Humans or something like this. And it's a novel in which the author imagines that prominent British mathematician solves the Riemann hypothesis. And some alien civilization, you know, from very distant galaxy, and discovers this and sends one of them to take control, to kill that mathematician, disguise himself into him, and to kill everybody who has had access to the proof, because that proof is very dangerous because it could give the humans some new technology that eventually would become a threat to the aliens. So they come to do this, and the guy, you know, this alien, he comes, but in the process, in the middle of his mission, he falls in love with the humans, and eventually he will not perform his mission, etc. But this alien being, he, you know, to his adoptive son, he writes some wisdom sentences to help him for the rest. And he, one of these wisdom sentences is, you know, even if your civilization did not discover it yet, literature and poetry are really part of mathematical sciences. And he adds also, however, economics is part of religion. And it shows that maybe one day we discover emotions are part of mathematical sciences.